A painting like The Scream, of course, Munch's The Scream, resonates with everyone who's been sort of terrorized by their own thoughts and feelings. And that sort of image of Munch on the bridge and so almost separating from his family, which is very religious and somewhat constipated in terms of generational values and so on. But something like this can resonate and hence elevate a painter dramatically. I want to talk about interpretation of a painting. For me, it makes sense if I'm going to make myself out to be the major artist that I believe I am. I have to paint the age of anxiety that we live in, and yet everything is, this is Rorschach. Everything comes down to this fact that we have valuation inside our brain that is derivative of whatever the cultural biases are that we grow up with, and they become embedded in the frontal cortex, and the way it frames up experience also is illustrative of how we capacitate our brains, and hence we every painting that you look at, in a sense, is a Rorschach. And something that you bring your own valuation and prescriptive, prescriptive interpretation towards. So this one here is Rorschach, Endgame. But if you turn it this way, you know, I can find a nose here, chin here, and of course that's all accidental, and a lot of art is totally accidental. This is my floor here, pretty accidental. Well, accident. And if I take something, just, you know, an image like this, and I put it in some sort of context where it is discontinuous with its own surroundings, then that's the sort of incongruity that I try to get in my trip movies that I'll be uploading. Dissonance, trying to find out those images that are very different than what you see on TV, but obviously somewhat similar because they're images. This one is called Lost in the Shuffle. This one here is called Job Interview. And what's important here is that for me, a painting is always in a dynamic. And to me, there's a crushing sort of dynamic to what's going on with this character, to, you know, this level of dishevelment. And that becomes the key signature to what I'm trying to do is flesh out the dynamic, particularly reflective of the age of anxiety that we live in, but make it colorful, make it interesting, making it not something that you're just automatically going to deflect away from because it is outside the valuation range of your own frontal cortex. This one, I was stuck with this one, and I couldn't see it becoming anything that for the longest time. And now I call it male menopause. At any rate, this is what I'm trying to get at, that, you know, art is not something that's neat. It's something that is investigative. It should be interesting, it should be engaging, and if it's just something fairly straightforward, like a nature scene, you can look at it for a few minutes and then you can't really talk about it, you can't really get into it. I often paint over paintings, and this is what I'm going to paint over. I actually thought it might be original because it's got surface, but there's something in the texture that makes me think it's probably a winner's painting, which, you know, a lot of them are good. It's certainly made to look like a real painting. At any rate, I could easily get away with, if I want to exploit the dynamic, I don't find it there. I find a little bit of dynamic here that I could work with. But I think ultimately I'm looking at this dynamic here. There's almost an airplane here. I don't want to articulate an airplane, but that gives it a certain energy, and whether I make this bottom into a face or something. The point is, a dynamic shifts depending on how you look at the relationship of what's going on in the painting. And to me, energy here is not as dynamic as energy here. You know, this makes it into a Carl Appel, whereas the other way was just sort of strained monotony. And my paintings are designed to make you ask, well, you know, what the hell is essentially going on here? And that provokes that originality within your own thinking. You've never thought about this sort of stuff before, particularly clashing in your subconscious and, you know, confronting that, because it's outside of that valuation range of your frontal cortex. And you may have to work at it, but once you get, you know, asking yourself, well, what is the actual meaning of this in terms of symbols? Like, I could say a tangerine rhymes with orange in the sense that, in a pictorial sense, the two seem very, very related. In a verbal sense, no. But that's the whole language of metaphor and analogy and allegory and all the things, all the subconscious resonances that any sort of painting can actually arouse in a person. Okay, ambiguity can be a sort of generalized faces emerging, strangers come out of the rain, or this one has both abstract ambiguity and social relativity, this sort of remote here, this sort of character tied up. The sort of death up here on the pipes, on the plumbing, the sense that there's a relaxedness, but at the same time, a turning away. And that becomes an ideation derivative that makes a painting even more depth-oriented, and you attach certain meanings to it. It's not a walk in the park type painting, therefore it has a dynamic of isolation and hedonism gone wrong. So the thing is that with art, the more questions you can ask and the bigger questions you can ask, and how those questions are indeed provoked by works of art, That becomes what's essential, hence the essence of what art is, to make your plasticity fluid so that you can write it out, navigate a painting, navigate your own interior capacity for thinking beyond the brackets of your own frontal cortex. This is a painting I bought at auction, and it's got such depth of feeling, but a sense of confinement, of anguish, mediated to various degrees of understanding by the various characters. This is a painting by Paul Allman, a painter from Guelph living with schizophrenia. I love this image of sort of meditation, looking into the head, and yet the man is inside the fish. You think of Leonard Cohen, Fish on a Hook, or Night from an Old Fashioned Book. There's that primal relationship. Christ is a fish figure, also figures in Eastern religion. So you've got a very sort of complex but uncertain thing going on here, and that's its beauty. And this face isn't too far from the anguish faces. I see these as children. This perhaps as this person's father, and this as the younger man's wife. But some conflict seems to be sorted out. But different people will look at the painting and see different things. That's not a bad thing, but looking at it in terms of its complexity is what is most provoking, and that's the level of engagement that this painting brings to the viewer. What art is ultimately is something that should inform us about ourselves, and from the cave paintings long ago that established a perspective on human activities like hunting and spear throwing and so on. We need to always take this step outside ourselves to see who we are becoming, what we're changing into. And art for the longest time was simply an exposition of something in the external world painted as accurately as possible or in the religious realm. Then with Impressionism, with light on water, sunlight on water, wriggling its way through, one realizes that one brings consciousness to it. And then with Expressionism, which is closer to my style of art, or Cubism, or Surrealism, or Dadaism, you know, the ball keeps on rolling in terms of who we are and what we are. To live in some artificial niche where landscape painting and pretty art and even thinking about art as fetching prices, or if it's sales worthy, or are you selling art? If you don't sell art, then you're not even considered an artist. But that's not the point of art. The point of art is it is always going to be entangled in this evaluation that comes from our frontal cortex, how we size up things, and then we prescriptively, over time, habitually value certain things. And that's precisely why it's hard to break through this art ideation with new art, because people become very established in their thinking of what constitutes art. And then the thing that makes one scream is, on some of my uploads here, you'll see my wife Christina and myself throwing paintings in the dumpster. I had to send 140, I thought I had them wrapped up, I had them on skids and wrapped in plastic and tarps, but the weather got to them and they were in pretty bad shape. Some not in so bad shape, but it hurts to see those paintings go into the dumpster heading for the landfill, just because there was no room in the inn.